You're listening to the audio production of How Not to Read the Bible, making sense of the anti-women, anti-science, pro-violence, pro-slavery, and other crazy-sounding parts of Scripture, by Dan Kimball, published by Zondervan and read by the author. Please note that you may download an accompanying PDF that provides enhanced materials for this audiobook. The print version of this book contains many graphics and illustrations that are useful to look at when they're being described. To download the PDF, please visit www.harperchristianaudio.com. Foreword. I love this book, and it's not just because Dan is my friend. I love it because he tackles some of the toughest challenges of our day with biblical faithfulness. Even though I am an apologist, I took a ton of insights away from this book, and I know you will too. As a college professor, speaker, and part-time high school teacher, I interact with young people regularly. The questions that Dan addresses in this book are exactly the ones that come up frequently in my conversations with both Christians and non-Christians. I'm guessing you have wrestled with these questions as well. Does the Bible demean women? Is the Bible anti-science? How could a loving God command such violence in the Old Testament? Does the Bible endorse slavery? These are real questions that many people today wrestle with. While these questions are not necessarily new because of technology, younger generations today are bombarded with them like never before. In order to be confident in our own faith and to help seekers with genuine questions, we must have answers to these questions. See 1 Peter 3:15. Specifically, there are a few reasons I love this book. First, it's practical. Some apologetics books, like Evidence That Demands a Verdict, offer answers and evidence for faith. Other books, like Tactics, a Game Plan for Discussing Your Christian Convictions, are designed to help believers navigate spiritual conversations. Yet this book offers both content and methodology, a rare trait for a book of its kind. This book not only will help you find answers to some difficult questions, it will also help you learn how to read your Bible well. Second, it's interesting. This is not a dry apologetics book. Dan uses a ton of contemporary examples. For example, in chapter 3, he discusses the importance of reading a particular Bible verse in light of the broader storyline. How does he make this point sink in? He cites this famous line from the Star Wars movies: "Just for once, let me look on you with my own eyes." This line makes no sense in isolation, but if you know who spoke it, Darth Vader, and why he spoke it, he removed his mask to see his son, Luke Skywalker, who had just learned that Vader is his father, shortly before Vader's death, then it makes more sense. The same is true for Bible verses. Third, it's honest. When addressing difficult issues, the temptation is to overstate our case. Dan offers thoughtful and forceful responses to many tough questions, but he doesn't overstate his case. I was really struck by how, in the last chapter of the book, he says that there is no truly satisfactory emotional answer to why God commanded the killing of children and infants. There's no escaping it. These passages are jarring. Of course, Dan believes God is just, but the point is that this book is refreshingly honest about the emotional challenges of faith. A ton more could be said about this book. I hope you will listen to it. How Not to Read the Bible is perfect for a small group, and it is ideal to give to a non-believing friend so you can discuss the content together. Sean McDowell. Prelude. Becoming Atheist by Reading the Bible. Reading the Bible is the fast track to atheism. Penn Jillette. Sitting on my desk is a printed email from a university student who, after growing up in a Christian family and being active in his church, is no longer a Christian. The email lists several reasons why he went from being a Christian and even a leader in his campus ministry to becoming an atheist. It's not an angry email, the student isn't disillusioned by the church, and when we later met in person, he told me that he had a positive church experience and is thankful for his former youth leader. He didn't leave the faith because of boring preaching or irrelevant worship music. He told me he left the faith because he finally got around to reading the Bible. Yes, reading the Bible led him to become an atheist. Before going away to college, this student regularly attended church and he listened to sermons every week. He attended church Bible studies for many years. He knows all the popular Bible stories, Daniel in the lion's den, David and Goliath, and many others. He loves Jesus' teaching in the Sermon on the Mount, where he talks about not judging others and giving to the needy and loving your enemies. When he left to attend college, however, he began reading parts of the Bible that he had never read before, stories he couldn't recall ever being preached or taught in the youth group and church he grew up in. The more he read, the more questions and objections he had. I found him to be an extremely intelligent, friendly person, open to discussion, and kind and positive as he spoke about his church experience. He shared that after being active in his high school youth group, in college he joined a study group with an on-campus Christian ministry. They chose the Old Testament book of Exodus for their study, but as he read it and studied it, he noticed things he hadn't seen before, things that horrified him. He encountered disturbing, crazy-sounding Bible verses, and it was his reading of these verses that shook the foundation of his faith. Why is it okay for God to kill children like King Herod did? In an email to his campus ministry leader, he listed verses from Exodus 4:21-23 as an example. They cover the story of the last of the 10 plagues God visited on Egypt, the plague where God instructed Moses to tell Pharaoh, "Because you refuse to let my people go, I will kill your firstborn son." And in Exodus 12:29-30, God followed through on that threat. At midnight, the Lord struck down all the firstborn in Egypt. Pharaoh and all his officials and all the Egyptians got up during the night, and there was loud wailing in Egypt, for there was not a house without someone dead. After reading this, the student wrote in his email, "I was devastated to think a loving God could predetermine the death of so many of the innocent." When we met, he said, "It's ironic that Christians recoil in horror and anger when they read the New Testament story of King Herod's trying to kill the newborn Jesus by killing all the boys 2 years old and under who were living in Bethlehem and nearby at the time of Jesus' birth. Christians rightly see that as a horrendous act of evil, a massacre of toddlers and infants. And they see King Herod as wicked and heartless. Yet he never hears Christians complain about the Exodus story. Why is it okay for God to do the same thing King Herod does, but with Egyptian infants and toddlers? Why is it wicked and evil when Herod does it, but acceptable when God does it?" Slavery and magical underwear. As he continued reading Exodus, the student found other disturbing verses. He mentioned Exodus 21:20-21, which reads, "Anyone who beats their male or female slave with a rod must be punished if the slave dies as a direct result. But they are not to be punished if the slave recovers after a day or two, since the slave is their property." And in Exodus 21:7, we read that a father can sell his daughter to someone else. It angered him to read that God seems to consider a human being someone's property and appears to be perfectly fine with this property being beaten and sold. He mentioned finding other strange things, like the clothing in Exodus 28:42-43. In this passage, priests are commanded to wear what sounds like magical underwear when they approach the altar in the holy place to worship God. If a priest doesn't wear this magical underwear, he will die. Understandably, this student began to wonder, Why haven't I been told that the Bible endorses slavery and instructs us to wear magical underwear when we come before God? Why doesn't God like women? As the questions kept coming, he began researching online. But he said that made things even worse. The deeper he dug for answers, the more disturbing were the things he found about the Bible. He discovered websites that were dedicated to exposing all the crazy, unsettling verses in the Bible. And it wasn't just the Old Testament that upset him. There were several passages in the New Testament. He mentioned 1 Timothy 2:11 and 12, where it says, "A woman should learn in quietness and full submission. I do not permit a woman to teach or to assume authority over a man. She must be quiet." Another verse, 1 Corinthians 14:34 and 35, reads, "Women should remain silent in the churches. They are not allowed to speak, but must be in submission, as the law says. If they want to inquire about something, they should ask their own husbands at home, for it is disgraceful for a woman to speak in the church." These verses, right there in his Bible, seem to be God's endorsement of men's superiority and even dominance over women. Was God commanding gender inequality, chauvinism, discrimination, and the oppression of women? It certainly appeared so. Connecting with the deconverting and deconstructing. Searching online, he not only found other people raising questions about these disturbing Bible verses, he also discovered others like him, former Christians who had left their faith. Many had been raised in a church, but after taking a closer look at their Bibles, they discovered things they had never been taught. For instance, one young woman on Twitter writes, "I read the Bible cover to cover twice in my youth. I remember encountering verses that made me uncomfortable, but I dismissed them. I started reading it again last year. I got to the 6th chapter in Genesis before dropping my head and crying. The God I believed in was a monster." Finding this community and hearing stories that reflected his own experience contributed to his growing loss of confidence in the Christian faith in which he had been brought up. He found he could no longer believe in salvation through Jesus because the Jesus he had been taught about was in a Bible he could no longer trust. Pastors and church leaders regularly encourage us to read our Bibles. Yet here is the great irony. It was reading the Bible that caused this student, and an increasing numbers of others like him, to leave Christianity. It's not only Christians who notice this. But the problem goes farther than Christians leaving the faith in which they were raised. The Bible is a stumbling block for many non-Christians as well. The strange and disturbing verses they read prevent them from taking the Bible seriously. One Sunday morning, after I had finished teaching at our church, I stopped by a room where people go when they need prayer. A young woman came up to me, and I could tell she was upset. This isn't all that unusual, since people going through tough times and dealing with difficult issues often come to this room for prayer. But as I listened to her, I realized hers wasn't the typical prayer need. She didn't have a loved one with cancer or a relational breakup. She wasn't losing her job. She wanted prayer to help her understand what she was reading in her Bible. She told me she was exploring Christianity and had been coming to the Sunday worship gatherings for a couple of months. A few weeks ago, she decided to read the Bible for herself, but as she began reading in Genesis, she grew discouraged and found her excitement about Christianity sinking. What was it that disturbed her? She shared how right there on page 1, the Bible seems to suggest that the earth was made in only 6 days. She had been taught her whole life, in science classes and by the media, that the universe is billions of years old. Then, quite unexpectedly, she read on page 3 about a talking snake. She was shocked, thinking this was a fictional story, something like The Jungle Book. Farther along, she read about people living to be well over 900 years old. She also read how the animals of the world followed Noah into a boat, like he was a fantastical Dr. Doolittle, but much worse, because God then killed thousands and thousands of people in a destructive flood, including children. She read about Abraham being told by his wife to have an affair so they could have a baby. She read about the woman turned into a pillar of salt by God. She read about God telling Abraham to kill his young son as a sacrifice. She was visibly upset as she described all of this and told me she had to stop reading the Bible at this point, fearful of what else she would find in its pages. After all, this was only the first half of the first book of the Bible. She told me she had initially been excited about exploring faith in Jesus. In the teachings at church, she said she had heard about grace and forgiveness and was drawn to Jesus because of what she had heard about him. But she had no idea, no warning at all, that these disturbing and crazy ideas were also in the Christian Bible. Apologetically, she admitted that she had wondered whether Christianity was a cult because she could not understand how thinking people could believe what she was reading to be true. How could they take all of this seriously? This young woman's interest in exploring faith in Jesus came to an abrupt halt after she began reading the Bible. A vast number of people aren't exploring Christianity and will never make it to reading a Bible like this young woman did. They see only clever online memes with Bible verses about slavery, women being told to be silent, and talking snakes, and won't likely ever take the Bible seriously or explore the Christian faith. Bloody Big Toes, A Sneezing Dead Boy, and End Times Battle Maps. I assume you're listening to this book because you saw the title and, like the young people I mentioned, have questions about some of the crazy things you've heard or read about in the Bible. You might be a Christian and find that you are growing more uncomfortable as you become aware of the Bible verses and stories that you never paid much attention to before. And you might be wondering, how do thinking people understand and believe the weird and disturbing things found in the Bible? You might be listening to this because you have a friend or family member who is doubting and even deconstructing their faith.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.